welcome to the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium on this Sunday afternoon for the final regular season home match for your Samford Bulldogs. If you're wondering why there's no on-camera stand-up before this one, you can put the blame on me for that. Well, who is me, you might ask? I'm your host, Eric Biancalana, and alongside me is Macy Marin. Believe me, folks, we're just as sad as you that this 2016 season is nearing its close.
Right, and Samford has had such a remarkable season. Coming into this game in the midst of a four-game winning streak, they are led by senior Jermaine Siobisinwe, who has scored 12 goals this season. Siobisinwe is currently in second place for Samford's record of goals scored in a season. Malkanisha Kelly holds that record with 13 goals.
Now on to today's match, which is a clash between the top two spots in the conference as Eastern Tennessee State University, the visitors this afternoon, shared first place in the Southern Conference table with the Dogs up until last Friday night. Now they're looking to get back to the top.
Right, East Tennessee State is coming into this game on a four-game undefeated streak after three consecutive wins against SoCon opponents and a tie against the UTC Mocs last Friday night, 0-0. They have outscored their opponents 35-20 this season. Led by their leading goal scorer, sophomore Eleonora Goldani, the Bucks will be coming in strong and with lots of momentum.
With only one weekend left in conference play, both of these teams are out to make sure they control their own destiny as the conference tournament quickly approaches. Stay tuned after the break for starting lineups and kickoff. You are watching Samford Bulldogs Soccer on the SoCon Digital Network.
Discover new things is good. For example, you may discover that the best bank in town isn't a bank.
At Express Oil Change and Tire Engineers, we believe in service.
Maintenance service, tire service, repair service,
and most importantly, customer service.
We believe in treating our customers with respect and integrity while offering all the services you need for your car.
Most of all, at Express Oil Change and Tire Engineers,
we believe in keeping cars on the road, keeping families safe,
and keeping you coming back whenever the need arises.
Well, welcome back here to the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium where we are live as play quickly approaches. Let's run through the pregame normalcies for you as we get down to action. The weather here in Birmingham is a cool 72 degrees, bit cloudy, bit overcast, did rain a bit earlier. We'll see what effect that has on the match. The Bulldogs will be in their traditional home kits with the white tops and the blue bottoms attacking from left to right on your screen, while ETSU will be in their blue tops attacking from right to left. Your officials this afternoon, center referee in the middle of the park is Kevin Broadley, and his assistants are Sam Byerster and David Jay. Now on to the starting lineups. Dogs have Anna Maddox back in goal. Emily Jones retains her spot in the starting lineup, but what else is new? Alongside her, Abriella Argueta, Taylor Borman, Malkanisha Kelly, Jermaine Siopasenwe, Anna Allen, Allie Laurie, Taylor Manide, Virginia McNeil, and Olivia Cole round out the starting lineups for the Dogs. Meanwhile, for the visitors, Cutshaw is in goal with McCurley, Dodge, Hodgson, Goldini, Brooch, Ray, Reister, Daniels, Vienne, and Allen rounding out the starting lineup as we are underway here at the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium for the final regular season home game of the 2016 season for the Samford Bulldogs. Alongside me, as usual, is Macy Marin. Macy, how are you doing this afternoon? Tell us a little bit about the two sides as we get started here.
Right. Big matchup being played here for the SoCon. Really going to determine if Samford is able to take control of this conference. Coming into a game, Samford is on a 2-1 home victory against Western Carolina on Friday. I thought it was interesting to see that Argetta was able to get the starting position this week, and I think she definitely earned it last game.
Absolutely. She has been fantastic since coming back from injury early on in the season. The 5'4" junior out of Clarksville, Tennessee, just 10 appearances this year, but has 2 goals and 5 assists to show for it. She has made a quick start since coming back from that early season absence. And you did mention the impact that this match would have on the Southern Conference table. We've got number 1 and number 2 out here playing in front of us this afternoon. Pardon me. Number 3, it's a close one at the top as I was looking down the Southern Conference table, and ETSU has put together a very nice string of games. So these two teams definitely going to be duking it out for that top spot as the season wears on and draws to a close here over the next couple of weeks.
Right, and ETSU coming in after heading to after being in Chattanooga last Friday, tying them 2-2. So they're going to be coming in looking for that win. It did rain a little bit earlier, so it will be interesting to see if the weather has any effect on how the ball bounces or is played, passing, being slow. It looks like right now they're doing just fine.
Well, the Bucks are on the ball now, and they want to go long. That pass just a bit wayward. Will roll out of play. Emily Jones is on the throw for the Dogs. Ball's going to stay on that far flank. The Bucks going to have the throw on this occasion. ETSU coming into this match 9-4-2 overall, 4-1-1 in SoCon play. They are 4 matches undefeated, all of those coming in the Southern Conference. They've been perfect at home this season, but just a 3-4-2 record on the road. So all of the blemishes on their record coming away from home.
Right, and this is actually only the 5th time ETSU will play Samford in their school history. Their first game was in 2002. And then ETSU rejoined the SoCon Conference in 2014 when they started playing them. Samford owns a 3-1 series against ETSU.
Now Borman looking forward for Allen and finding her. Here's Siopa Senway in the center of the pitch. Looking to squeeze one through for the run of Allen. Pass night not quite there on that occasion. And that one will dribble out for a ETSU throw-in.
Just kind of observing in the first few minutes, I think this game is going to be a little different than the ones we've previously had. ETSU has already had the ball on their attacking side and are putting pressure on Samford, a little bit something that we haven't seen. They've been playing some teams.
A chance for Argetta here as she goes up to challenge Cutshaw.
They're playing some teams. This ETSU team is better, I believe, than any team that they've played in a while. So definitely going to be a challenge. They're going to have to step up and really be aggressive and be able to defend this ball against ETSU.
Borman switches the play over to Argetta. She's got Siopa Senway in front of her. Just dawdling on the ball a bit there was Argetta, turning it over to Hodgson. Ray tidy in possession for the Bucks. Dogs on the offensive here in the early going. Emily Jones going to get us started again with the throw. Has Kelly in support.
Little miscommunication there, I believe.
That attempted switch of play, neither to Manid or Argueta. But back at the feet of Argueta now. Well, McNeil caught taking too much time on the ball. Here's Allen.
And that's something that Samford isn't used to. They're used to having plenty of time in the midfield to take as many touches as they want. And this ETSU team is really applying the pressure on them in the midfield.
Yeah, Macy, it's something that you've harped on all season long, and you have not been wrong about it at all. The time and space that the Bulldogs have had in the midfield has allowed them to create a lot of chances going forward. And in the early stages here this afternoon, it does not look like the Bucks are willing to give them that time. Vienne with the throw in for the Bucks. She's got support, but Anna Allen is there to make it difficult. Now here's McCurley on the far side. She's going to send a high cross into the box. There's a chance here. Lori is equal to the task, and the bouncing volley is eventually cleared by McNeil. Bucks not done, though. Olivia Cole needing to make the clearance on this occasion. And if we're used to seeing Samford come right back at the opponents, usually here at home it's the Bucks who are continuing to attack. Here's Allen with a left-footed strike, and Maddox is down to make the save quite comfortably in the end, but early pressure from ETSU. I just want to make the distinction here that both teams have a starter named Allen. I'll do my best to add the first name in. Now, this might just be a chance for Siopa Senwe. The first touch is heavy, but she's in the area. Here's Siopa Senwe at the byline. Cross comes in, and it's cleared away. Only as far as Allen, though.
Now that through ball there was impressive. I think that's going to be probably Samford's strategy. Go to the corners and hit the through balls to get past this ETSU defensive line.
Here's McNeil in the center of the park. Pass just a bit wayward for Anna Allen. Long ball over the top could be dangerous for the Dogs. It's Manid trying to shield it for her goalkeeper, and she does effectively as Anna Maddox was out off her line to scoop it up.
I think for Samford that right now they just really need to slow down and play their game. Some of their touches in these first few minutes have not been something that we're used to. I think they're a little flustered having this added pressure, but if they can just slow down, I think they'll be okay.
I think you hit the nail on the head right there. They're not used to teams closing them down this quickly. And now every time they get on the ball, they're expecting a challenge to come in. Referee has given the free kick and wants to have a word with Jermaine Siopa Senwe. And he wants to give the card as well. Jermaine Siopa Senwe picking up the yellow card in the early stages here. That's her second of the season for the challenge in the back of the ETSU forward.
And the fouls helped her out last game. They were in her favor. She was able to have two penalty kicks to beat Western Carolina. The score was 2-1, a very close game, and her penalty kicks were obviously very important there.
And that was Isabel Hodgson being fouled just some 22 yards out, and it will be Georgia Allen over the free kick. She's in a position where she could send a cross in, could try and curl this one up and over the wall. Definitely a dangerous position here for the visitors. It will be Allen to strike it, and Maddox is down to make the save. Danger not done yet, as the scrape in front of the goal is eventually hacked away.
Nice job there by Samford defenders getting back and protecting their line when their goalkeeper was out.
VN with Hodgson in support. Hodgson wants to go on her own. The two number 10s, Siopa Senway clashing in the middle, and this time Siopa Senway, adjudged to have been fouled. She's not too happy about it. She does need to be careful as she is already in the book. Doesn't need to be giving the referee any harsh words.
This game is a very important game, and it looks like there'll be some high emotions and tension going on. Maybe some more physical play than we're used to seeing.
ETSU so far are putting up the biggest fight against the Bulldogs that we have seen from any Southern Conference team this season. Allen and Jones exchanging passes on that far side. Jones wants to go over the top, and Kelly has a great first touch to take it down. He's got Borman on that outside flank in support. The cross is coming in towards Siopa Senway. Danger not done yet. Allen wants to have a go from distance. It is a tame one. Cutshaw will be happy to scoop that one up. Well, the last time these two met, it was a close one indeed. It was Malkanisha Kelly with just 4 minutes left on the clock last season in Tennessee, giving the Dogs the 1-0 victory. And with her goal, she clinched the Southern Conference regular season championship. A huge season last year for Malkanisha Kelly as she broke the single season goal scoring record for the Samford Bulldogs with 13 in a season. That game winner against ETSU, a part of those 13.
Kind of interesting while you were talking on that. There was a through ball to Malkanisha Kelly by McNeil, and she sent it right in front of the goal, and Kelly, obviously not very happy, pointed to the corner. That's where she wants the ball. And so we'll see if her teammates will get her the ball there.
Kelly's goal-scoring record, of course, being challenged this year by fellow teammate Jermaine Siopa Senway, who after her 2-penalty kick strikes last Friday night has 12 on the season, one shy of tying the single-season record. If Siopa Senway bags 2 more, she will break that record. And if she manages that, she will hold the single-season record for both goals and assists all-time for the Samford Bulldogs. Allie Laurie on the chase now defensively for the Dogs. When in doubt, kick it out. ETSU will have the throw.
It's interesting that that record is between Kelly and Siopa Senway because they do work, you've seen this season, they work so well together up top. And you would want them both to be able to hold the record if they could, obviously.
Would be interesting to see the stat, how many of each of their assists were to the other one. As I know, the two have set each other up for goals numerous times over the last couple of seasons. No foul, says the referee in the middle of the park. Argueta wants to play through Siopa Senway, but it's not enough on that one. Bucks very comfortable in possession, even in tight spaces, able to work that one out wide.
Right, it's interesting to me that they weren't able to beat Chattanooga, and it was just a tie 2-2. I do know it was a very long game going into two overtimes, or double overtime, but Samford was able to beat Chattanooga pretty easily. So it's kind of interesting. Wonder what happened in that game to make it go that way.
Samford made a change just there. Virginia McNeil leaving the park for redshirt sophomore Caitlin Orman, who has come into that midfield role. Looks like Anna Allen has dropped a little bit deeper as a result. It's this long ball over the top. Should be bread and butter stuff for Olivia Cole, who just wants to go back to her goalkeeper. Maddox's clearance does take a deflection on the way out. And Dog's making that one a bit more difficult than maybe it needed to be. Laurie says no nonsense this time around, and Siopa Senway can try and take it down out of the air.
Samford's going to have to start winning the ball in the middle of the field. ETSU is doing a great job of right now, maintaining possession in the middle.
And just as you say that, though, Siopa Senway is onto it. Not quite enough curl on the pass towards Kelly. will be a goal kick for Leanne Cutshaw. I've been mentioning the intensity that ETSU has come out with already in this game. They've only been shut out once all season long, so this is a team that is very used to scoring and getting on the board. We'll see if the Dogs can remain stout defensively to keep them out. Meanwhile, on the flip side, the Bucks have 6 shutouts of their own this season, 1 shy of tying the school record. So Olivia Cole will come take this free kick inside the ETSU half. Dogs will go short to Maneed. It's bouncing in the area. Orman's on the chase now. And here's Argueta. Orman can send the cross in. Borman might have a chance here. It's up in the air. Mack might get there. And now Siopa Senwe can come onto the ball on this near side. Probably looking for the deflection in the corner kick. Didn't quite get it, Siopa Senwe, as it was Cutshaw who opted to stay on her line. And Malkanisha Kelly, who I called Mack in the heat of the moment, nearly got to put a header on frame.
I think that was Samford's strongest attack yet of this game. Maybe seeing them get into a rhythm a little bit. Able to win that ball in the midfield and now stringing some passes together. That's something you usually don't see, that pass by Olivia Cole being far to the left. Usually see them being very accurate and knowing where each other are. It's kind of interesting to see that this Bucks aggressive play is kind of messing up how their simple passes and touches are.
Vien skipping past Siopa Senwe. She's got her head up and looking for options in front of her. Dogs calming down in possession a bit here, but still being harried at every opportunity by the Bucks. They've managed to switch the play out to some space with Emily Jones on that far flank. She wants to go towards Argueta up the line. But Argueta is closed down quickly, as has been the norm here so far this afternoon. Orman looking for the run of Siopa Senwe. Now here's Kelly. Neat touch to the inside for Kelly to get past her mark. Tries the give and go with Borman. Two not quite on the same page.
Right, I think there was a little bit of miscommunication there, but nice footwork by Malkanisha Kelly there to get past that defender. She's settling down a little bit too.
Will be another Samford substitution here. Ella Baggett checking in. Argueta stepping out for the time being. Ella Baggett, the 5'8 sophomore forward out of Clarksville, Tennessee. She's making her 14th appearance of the season. 4 assists for her on the year. Well, Manita and Allen getting a bit confused in the midfield means that Goldini has a chance until she is called offside by the referee on the far side of the pitch. Dogs want to get it started quickly as Cole finds Orman with plenty of space in the midfield. This is more what we're used to seeing, and this is not what you want to give the Bulldogs the room to do.
Right. The Bucks are very impressive. I was very impressed with them coming out and being so aggressive, hustling. They're still hustling to the ball, but if they start to get discouraged that they're not getting the opportunities that they've hoped for, letting Samford have time on the ball is definitely not what they need to do.
And we'll see if it was in the game plan for them to come out with that intensity for the first 10-15 minutes and then maybe lay off the gas pedal a little bit Definitely difficult to keep a high press like that up for the whole 45 minutes. Kelly has it in the area for the Dogs now. She's got a little space for herself, and the cross is deflected out. Will be a Dogs corner kick.
Last Friday night, Samford played at home with a victory 2-1 against Western Carolina, and that was also senior night and the Shauna House Charities night. Just to let everyone know, the Samford soccer team was able to help raise $13,000 for Shauna's house.
More on that after the corner kick from Borman. And the header is from Olivia Cole. Couldn't quite generate the direction on it, though. Cutshaw happy to watch that one sail wide of her post as Macy Marin over $13,000 raised for Shauna's house charity last Friday night. Head coach Todd Yelton saying he would have been happy with, or maybe was expecting something closer in the range of $3,000. And so he got about $10,000 more than he bargained for. And I do believe that in order for the house to become a reality, $93,000 is the target. And the charity has now raised somewhat in the vicinity of $78,000. So Shauna's house inching closer to reality. And what a wonderful cause that is. It's Taylor Borman's attempted dribble is knocked out.
Samford able to be getting back in your groove, as you would say. Jermaine Tipisone going up and intercepting that ball, getting that all started. They're starting to win it in the midfield.
Corner kick from Borman is at the back post, and it's on frame. Diving to her left to make the save is Leanne Cutshaw as the Dogs put their first one on target. It looked like it might have come off Malkanisha Kelly. And we will do it again from this near side corner. This one at the back post where Cole is up for it. Not quite cleared yet. It's Manid chasing it down. And that one will be knocked out for a Bucks throw. We were mentioning the Shauna's House Charity Foundation. If you are interested in making a donation, you can find the links on sanfordsports.com. Head over to the soccer page, and you will be directed to be able to leave a donation to that wonderful cause, to help the orphans in the Ukraine.
Samford able to now maintain possession in ETSU's defensive third. For quite a while, seeing a little bit more of what we're normally used to. The ball not able to get out before Samford defenders are sending it right back in.
Now Kelly has a chance here. She tries to bring it down at the top of the box. Nothing doing yet.
Olivia Cole able to swing it around, have some time on the ball.
We see that high press from the Bucks more and more as the Samford back line able to cope with it very adequately on this occasion. And good work from Borman means that Siopa Senwe is on the ball in the final third. She's got Kelly, whose flick is almost an excellent one into the path of Borman. And there's Lori mopping up the danger at the back for the Bulldogs. Allie Lori, the 5'7" defender, just a freshman, but has found herself in that back line more often than not this season. She's really built a consistent starting role alongside Olivia Cole. If you remember, Macy, Olivia starting all alone in the center of the defense in the early stages of the season, but Allie has worked her way into this lineup as conference play has continued.
And ETSU will have the free kick. It looks like number 5, Fiona Dodge, will be over this.
Here comes the long one from Dodge. It is into the Bulldog box, but it is no problem at all for Samford goalkeeper Anna Maddox.
I expected to see a little bit more pressure on Anna Maddox there.
Safety first from the back line of the Bucks. And Dog's going to have the throw in that far corner. to get that cross in is Baggett, but she's patient, has Jones in support. The two have worked a little bit of space.
Baggett did the smart thing there, even though she wanted to send the cross in, wait for it, dribble the ball around, wait for the pass, and send it back in.
Samford making a change here. It's Maya Watford entering the match, and Jermaine Siopa-Senwe will take a short intermission. Well, if ETSU is pressuring and working hard to get the ball back, the Dogs are too, as 3 to 4 Lady Bulldogs there were throwing their bodies into the mixer to get back on the ball, and they have it now.
Bucks with a throw in. They're going to choose to drop it back.
Here's Vienne right in front of her own bench. Not getting a lot of help, has to exchange a couple passes with her center back. Now the check two is from Hodgson, who is dispossessed in the midfield.
Nice pressure there by Samford. Starting out with Maya Watford up top to really apply the pressure on that defensive line.
Here's Manita at the halfway line. Nothing doing in front of her. She's stood on the ball for too long and been dispossessed. Another one knocked over the top for the Dog back line to chase, but it is too heavy and all the way into the hands of Animatix.
About 18 minutes of play left in this half, and we're still 0-0. Lots of action, though, this game in the first half.
Taylor Borman working hard to win it back for the Dogs, and she's got movement up in front of her. She's looking for that run from Ella Baggett, and it is a good ball.
That was a great ball. Ella Baggett just not able to get her body in front of that ETSU defender there. Nice thought, for sure.
Emily McCurley tracking back and doing well to make the clearance. Meanwhile, a couple substitutions happening here. Corey Sauter entering in the wake of Malkanisha Kelly's exit. And for ETSU, Molly Collinson checks into the match as Irina Bruch makes way for her. That one did strike the hand. Thought the referee might allow play to go on just for a moment there, as it didn't look intentional, but he has given the free kick in a dangerous, dangerous position for the Dogs. Borman's going to stand over this one. It's got Allen, Sauter, and Watford waiting to make a run at the back post.
McCurley kind of stopped there. She knew she had the handball. I think that's probably why the ref called it.
She did look guilty. Here it comes from Borman, and she's going to that top corner. My goodness, it was Cutshaw who was equal to the curler from Borman that looked like it was going to squeeze its way into that upper 90.
Cutshaw has had a great game so far, very impressive saves.
And she is the only thing between a 0 and a 1 on the scoreboard for the Bulldogs. So Manid looks to lob one into the box. Allen's got a chance here, and Allen shots into the back of the net. Anna Allen opens the scoring against ETSU off an absolutely sublime through ball from Taylor Manid. It's Bulldogs 1, Bucks 0.
Great job by Anna Allen doing what every coach tells you. Follow the ball until the play is stopped. She did just that, and she was able to get that nice touch into the back of the net. Very impressive.
And there was still plenty of work for Allen to do as she got onto the end of that one, as she had the keeper to beat, and she had a ball that was bouncing up to deal with, and she placed it superbly into the far bottom corner
It'll be interesting to see how ETSU responds to this, if they'll stay on their toes like they have been and really pressuring hard, or if they'll kind of lose a little bit of life.
Right after that goal, Sarah Smeltzer checked into the match for Taylor Borman. And we are back underway with the home side in the lead. How about that assist from Taylor Maneed, Macy? Some pass from her. Caught the entire ETSU back line stepping out, and it was Anna Allen who was onside, timing her run excellently.
Right. Once again, something you're used to seeing Samford do, know where their fellow players are and be able to send that ball off late in practice. They've practiced so much those through balls and how to time their runs. It was very impressive.
Allie Laurie with a no-nonsense clearance inside of her own 18. It's going to be Pauline Vienne to come up and take this throw. Vienne's got a chance to put the cross in, and she does it to the near post. Comes back across face, and Dog's able to clear it, but the danger not gone yet. Jones is up battling for it, and she does well on both occasions. Gets onto her own clearance and has Ella Baggett as an outlet pass. Superb work at the back from Emily Jones.
Right, definitely in danger there. The ball was passed right in front of the goal and was there for a few seconds. Molly Collinson for the Bucks did a nice job of starting off that attack.
Here's Orman with some space. Sees the run of Smeltzer in front of her. Allie Laurie quick and aware to intercept Georgia Allen. Now the Dogs can turn defense into offense as Watford charges towards the byline. She is dispossessed at the pivotal moment. Well, Caitlin Orman's hard work at the center of the park has left Georgia Allen distressed and has also left the Dogs with the throw in at the halfway line.
Eleonora Goldini pressuring there, and she leads this Bucks team with 12 goals this year. She's a sophomore from Italy, and she's played on the U19 and U17 Italian national team. She's also helped her team, new Team Ferreira, win two Fustel championships. So definitely an asset to this ETSU team.
Baggett sending one in. Smeltzer's got it at her feet, wants it on her right foot. It's Orman. Shot is blocked from outside the area.
Well, great job there by McNeed.
The hustle from McNeed, yes. Has the home crowd cheering quite loudly.
Staying with it. She was almost beat there, but hustled back. The crowd thought that was a Samford throw-in, but regardless, she was able to stop playing. A great hustle there by Taylor.
Here's Georgia Allen now on it for the visitors. Now Goldani puts it out wide, wants to cross back into the area. 4-5 in the box for ETSU. None able to get onto that cross. But the visitors really piling the ladies forward when they do have a chance.
Yeah.
very impressive work by the Bucks. Collins to hold on to possession, and that one bounces into the hands of Maddox.
Right, nice job there by Maddox saying, you know, I've got this. Let me get it instead of there being any confusion in front of the box.
Bit of a loose touch from Anna Allen in the center of the park. Now ETSU can come forward with their own Georgia Allen.
Georgia Allen has done a great job of being able to distribute the ball in the midfield. As I say that, she had a bad touch, but she has done a great job so far this game.
Commentators curse from Macy Marin on that occasion. Smeltzer has it at the top of the area.
Nice turn by Smeltzer.
She's passed one defender, got a couple more to beat. Hard tackle comes in.
She might have should have laid that off to her fellow teammate on the left line there. Not really sure who that is right now.
Meanwhile, Collinson coming up this near side. Well, Taylor Meneed was about to take the throw, but not before number 14, Molly Collinson, has gone down with a bit of a knock right here on this near side touchline. She's receiving attention from the trainers.
Looks like they're taking her ankle brace off. I'm not sure if that's all she needed to be done or...
She does look to be walking all right.
Right. Maybe she just needed that brace off. She appears to be fine right now.
Well, Collinson is back up and at him, and the referee is going to allow a couple changes to be made in this intermission. Rachel Harbin is going to step onto the pitch for the visiting team. And entering for the Bulldogs was number 17, Keely Borman. Allie Laurie is up tall to deal with that. Now Collinson, without her brace, is on the ball at the top of the area and wants the shot with her left foot.
Collinson did a great job there of kind of stopping her run, pulling it back, and then going for the shot.
Cole going in hard with the challenge. Pardon me, that was Jones. Now Keely with her first couple of touches. Smeltzer sends it up the flank. And all the way to the byline goes Sauter.
She'll get that corner kick.
She does get the corner kick.
Nice job by Sauter there to get in front of that defender and force the corner.
Sauter will take her own corner kick, and she does want to go short. Gets it back. Now the cross comes in. Orman wants to knock it back into the mixer, and Sauter might be able to get there. That cross comes into the back post, and it's Smeltzer who's there to head it in. Can't miss from there. Sarah Smeltzer doubles the Dogs' lead with just under 9 minutes to play in this first half. Samford 2, ETSU 0.
Right, and I think that had the Bucks by surprise. They really did not think that they were going to be able to, Samford was going to be able to get the cross off, and she did. Remarkable.
Certainly had me by surprise. It looked very, very close to have going all the way over the line. But good work from Sauter to keep chasing that one down before it went out, and the high lobbed cross was over Cutshaw, and Smeltzer was chasing it down at the back post to head in from just a foot out.
Hey, Another opportunity here for Samford.
Well, that was Sarah Smeltzer's third goal of the year, the 5'6 senior from right here in Birmingham, Alabama, making her 15th appearance of the 2016 season and marking it with a goal.
Right, not only did she leave the ball in the back of the net, there were also a couple ETSU defenders stuck in the back of the net too, as they had fallen in with her as she headed that nicely.
It was a bit of a feat of bravery from Smeltzer, who nearly went crashing into the post, but you got to do what you got to do to get it in the back of the net.
Right, just under 8 minutes remaining. Samford up 2-0 over ETSU.
Good bit of depth in this Samford team as they're scoring some of these goals without their big names on the pitch. No Sia Pasenway, no Kelly, no Borman as of right now. Well, there is a Borman, the younger sister, of course.
Right. And this score really, I don't think, reflects exactly how this game has gone, especially looking back at other games that we have played in the first half score-wise. I think this ETSU team did come out very strong, and they are putting up a good fight. Samford just had two very nice goals.
Well, Dogs are making a change. Entering the match is number two, Aaron Bonner. Keely Borman making way. I think Keely Borman got a bit of a knock to the nose, has a little bit of blood, so had to exit the pitch as a result. Aaron Bonner, the 5'7 freshman from Deatsville, Alabama, coming in for her, making her 10th appearance of the year this afternoon.
A little bit too much time on the ball there as ETSU is able to disrupt that pass.
First time in a while the Bucks have gone on a 4A forward, and the pass for Goldani is behind her.
Goldani had a nice flick there behind her to get the ball to her teammate before that was interrupted.
Jones on the throw now. Under 6 minutes left in the first period.
Samford able to have some time on the ball, stringing some touches together along their back line.
Yeah, as quickly as the Bucks did come out, they have slowed a little bit, maybe understandably, as Dogs have really asserted their dominance on this match. Now here's Watford with work to do in the corner. Wants to take her time. Has Manid in support. Manid's going to put the first time outswinger in. Smeltzer and Bonner were there to challenge for it.
I must think that curved a little bit too much. Players had to come back and try to get that a little too far from the goal there.
Now here comes the cross from Jones. No Bulldog on the end of that one. Collinson coming forward now for the visitors. That one squeezes past Cole.
Unfortunately, when ETSU is able to come up, normally they only have one player up top. It makes it hard for them to get anything started. Their whole team isn't moving up as fast as they would like.
Meanwhile, Dogs always have two or three up there. One of those is Bonner, and her cross towards the back made for an awkward one between Vien and her goalkeeper Cutshaw, but the two were able to see it out for a goal kick.
Sarah was running.
Nice job there, Samford, able to win it in the middle.
It was Watford putting in a tough challenge, and Bonner, who chasing onto the end of it, adjudged to have been offside on this near touchline. Reister gets us restarted.
And you are correct. The latter half of this half, they have played without the, Samford has played without the big names, the Kelly, the Jermaine, the Sinwe. But you do have to think a lot of those players are seniors and they will be gone next year. So it's nice to see these younger girls get playing time and get points on the board as well against a very good ETSU team.
Good work from Smeltzer, sees her get away. Now there's a chance.
Maya Watford speed able to help her out a little bit there. But the Buck defender is able to get her pass off.
Georgia Allen charging forward against Anna Allen for the Bucks. And Emily Jones is quietly having herself quite a game at the left back position for the Bulldogs. And she makes another pivotal defensive interception. There she is again, Jones. Cool and calm to take that one out of the air. Smeltzer making that one a bit difficult for Anna Allen in the center of the park, and it will be a turnover as Maya Watford looks to be in some discomfort on this near side. She's going to go down and await the referee. Not looking very good for Maya Watford. Keely Borman is out quickly.
Not really sure exactly when this injury would have taken place, not if it's just a cramp or a...
Athletic trainers are out to double-check on her. Maya Watford, the 5'7 freshman out of Indianapolis, Indiana. Today marks her 10th appearance of the year. She has been one of the freshmen in this side, very consistently used by Samford head coach Todd Yelton. A lot of faith in her. She's recently back from suffering a concussion a couple weeks ago away from home. One assist for her on the year. She will continue to receive attention. There's just 2 minutes left before the halftime whistle blows. Referee has stopped the clock for this. She is back up on her feet. Watford receiving a round of applause from the home fans here.
Not really sure what this is. She does look very weak and in discomfort there as her coach and athletic trainer help her off the field.
Certainly very worrying. I wish Maya the best as she will continue to receive attention on the sideline.
I think we've gotten word that she might have gotten hit on the head. And that might be a cause to her injury.
Not good news at all after she, as I mentioned before, suffered a concussion. I believe it was in the away match against Wofford. Double check me if I'm wrong on that one. But a couple weeks back, she was feeling ready to come back onto the pitch last Friday night. So wish Maya the speediest of recoveries. But we are back underway as halftime quickly approaches. Anna Allen is bringing the ball forward for the Dogs.
Georgia Allen not applying as much pressure as we've seen her apply there in the midfield against Anna Allen. Interesting to see them go up against each other, both the Allens.
Georgia has been one of the more lively players for the Bucks this afternoon, and I've watched her slowly become more discouraged, as her body language alludes to, as the Bulldogs have continued to increase their lead.
Samford with way much or much more time on the ball than they had at the beginning of this game. Almost looks like a different ETSU team. It'll be interesting to see if coming out of this halftime they apply the pressure like they did in the beginning of this game.
They will need to make a change of some sort to get themselves back into this one, because now the Dogs are well and truly in front here. Collinson looking to change that. She cuts back into her right foot. Just a one in front of her, has to go back into the midfield towards Ray. And now the Bucks getting players forward as the two Allens continue to duke it out in the center of the park, and the referee has called this one in favor of the Bulldogs.
Seems like George Allen was the one who got the worst end of that, though. Limping a little bit, as it seems she had hit her knee a little bit.
And that will do it for first half action here at the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium. Dogs in front by two, and they really grew into the game and took control. Let me just recap some stats for you here before we go into the break. The visitors have taken four shots. Three of those have been on frame. Meanwhile, the Bulldogs have taken six of their own and put the same amount of those on goal. But as you know, two of those were turned in, and that's what separates the two sides after the first 45 minutes. Macy, what were you impressed with by the Dogs in this first half?
I think they came out a little slow. They weren't expecting this. I think it was impressive that they were able to still fight, hustle, maintain possession until they were able to get those two goals. I think it was very nice. I think they have to carry that in because I do think this ETSU team will come out strong, really trying to get the ball to Eleonora Goldani, which they have not been able to, their leading goal scorer. They definitely would like to get more shots on goal. So Samford will have to come out strong again going into this second half.
Well, Dogs at the top of the Southern Conference table as of right now. ETSU still close and still in this one. Another 45 minutes of action coming up after the break, so stay tuned here. You are watching Samford Bulldogs Soccer on the SoCon Digital Network.
This is Lauren. These are her first roommates, her first car, and her very first health insurance plan, Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alabama. Even at her age, she's not taking her health for granted. Her affordable health plan includes a routine annual checkup, apps, and programs that fit her lifestyle. Lauren may be just starting out, but with us, she's already got peace of mind. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alabama. We cover what matters. Find out how we can cover you for the first time.
Game day brings out the best in all of us. At Regions, every day is game day.
Samford actually has their fingerprints all over this, and that's exciting.
Just north of sunny San Diego in Carlsbad, California, the fourth annual Daniel Summit takes place. It's a gathering of who's who sports and entertainment executives from around the world. And the concept is simple, but extremely important.
An executive in the sports industry, we have tremendous influence in our culture. And it's named the Daniel Summit because, like Daniel in the Old Testament, he had tremendous influence in his culture of the day, and he used that influence to bring glory to God and to impact the culture in a significant way.
Dr. Darren White, the founder of Samford's sports marketing program, serves on the Daniel Summit Advisory Board and has his students directly involved, developing a five-year strategic plan to grow the summit's reach.
This year we've gone from 60 to 120 this year, so we've doubled the size of it, and it's really exciting. We have over 70 teams, you know, represented here at the Daniel Summit, and it's just really remarkable.
You're trying to reach into every single industry and find people from every single team. That's the goal. It's really cool to see that all the hard work we've put in you know, in strategic planning for this event, how it's paying off and to see it all come together.
In the spring, I started to put a lot of those action steps together that we as a class had worked on in the fall, which was really cool because we got to see a lot of the ideas that we came up with really come to life and really try to grow the summit. And obviously it's been a big success so far as we met our 100 threshold and even went beyond that to about 150, 120 people this year.
And outside of utilizing their sports marketing skills, Samford students are also making amazing contacts in an industry they hope to start a career in.
You see all these people, it's like the guys you see on TV or in the news reports, and I mean, they're there, and there's no media, there's nothing around, and so you're able to have a really one-on-one, heart-to-heart conversation about faith, about business, about life, and so it's been such an honor and such a blessing to have the opportunity to come here.
There are thousands of college students that would, you know, would love to have the opportunity to spend just 5 minutes with someone of this magnitude or level, you know, in the sports industry. And so for our students, we have a small select group that are out here rubbing shoulders for 2 days, you know, interacting with these executives and getting to know them. And you know, it is absolutely invaluable experience for them.
Brad Radisi, Samford University.
Hi, I'm Don Sandley, Chair of Theater and Dance at Samford University. Almost 20 years ago, I sat right in this chair and was introduced to this community. And in that time, I have seen some amazing work go across this stage. Growth in the program, new degrees, and some tremendous students come and share their talents. I look forward to a wonderful 2016-2017 as we continue to grow this wonderful program. We'll start our season with Sleeping Beauty, the classic tale. It's part of our Theater for Youth series and part of our new degree in Theater for Young Audiences. It's a BFA that is very unique, crafted carefully for all ages. We hope that you'll enjoy this show. We know it's going to be a family-friendly, wonderful work of art. We follow it up with the musical Nice Work If You Can Get It. Some of you may have seen it on Broadway with Matthew Broderick. It's a wonderful musical with some classic songs. One of the great strengths of Samford School of the Arts is that we work together seamlessly as an artistic family. Samford Opera Works will be producing The Marriage of Figaro, one of the great operas ever written. The theater department will be assisting in this production. So please put The Marriage of Figaro on your calendar as well. In the spring, we will bring you Arthur Miller's The Crucible, an American classic, a tale of greed, community, and what it means to be a proud American. We also are going to bring you a new work, part of our New Works musical initiative. It's a play that's never been seen in this part of the country and will be very exciting. We're keeping it a little bit mysterious, a little bit of a secret, so watch this space. In the spring, we will also be bringing you our annual dance concert. Our dance program is really growing, and this year we are delighted to be teaching all of our dance classes on campus. We will have new dance studio space in Seibert Hall, and we know that it's going to make a wonderful difference for our students. There are other opportunities for students to get involved in theater. We call it our studio season. It includes the 10-minute play festival, the one-act festival, and the freshman showcase. So there is something always happening in Harrison Theater. It's an exciting place for majors, for minors, and for Samford students in general. Come see us. You know you'll have a good time. So we want to welcome you to the Samford campus for music, for theater, for dance, for art, all under one roof at the Samford School of the Arts.
Strong, lasting relationships. It's what Samford builds, and you see it firsthand at Family Weekend. Here, you're not just visiting, you're a Samford Bulldog.
When we bring them here, we show them that, you know, it's okay, this is what I'm doing, this is what I'm a part of, meet all my friends, and it's kind of a way of just bringing two families together, not just family back home, but your family gets to meet your Samford family.
It's great to see not only our community and get to show that off, but show the parent community as well, and show the unity that we have between not just the different states, but the different organizations, and get to show off the place that we love.
And the crowds don't lie. Tailgate tents from across the country shout out the red and blue of Samford. Doing what family does supports you every step of the way.
That was one thing that my wife and I realized, you know, our first time on campus was that we were definitely going to be more involved and feel more at home than we would at other schools, and that hasn't stopped. I mean, we we feel like we're missing something when we're not here.
Everybody seems to know everybody. I passed by a gentleman a minute ago who was just greeting everybody, and he says, "What's your son's name?" I said, "Jalen Moore." He said, "Oh, I know Jalen." Uh-huh. So that makes you smile and makes you happy to know that the faculty know your child by name.
I went to a big SEC school. We thought our daughter was going to go to an SEC school. It's just a completely different environment. It's definitely a sense of family and community, and I'm amazed at how good of a job they do at making the parents feel a part of it.
For family members, they can come back to school too. The Samford Parents Academy at Family Weekend offers a variety of sessions ranging from Play-Doh to the planets, showcasing the Samford experience.
I hope they get the understanding of the community we have here at Samford. We're a close-knit community. They get one-on-one attention, just like they will have attention from a professor and not a TA. They'll actually see that we are actually involved in the classroom with the students. We're working one-on-one with them, just as we are with them today.
He's been really excited about going to class. He thinks that the professors are really engaging, and he's learning a lot, and he's challenged. So it's an exciting learning environment for him.
I want them to get a sense of what their students are reading while they're here. But I also want them to get a particular kind of classroom experience, that it's a classroom discussion. So I'm not lecturing them to them for an hour or so on Play-Doh. They have to actually participate the way students participate.
Family Weekend. It's about the visit, the fun, the smiles, but it's also a celebration, knowing that even after 175 years, Samford's future is very bright because of this caring community and its potential to grow.
Samford has just taught me that, you know, no matter where you are, there's always going to be someone who you can help or someone that can help you. And I just feel like overall, I'm prepared to go out in the real world, and I have Samford to thank for that.
We've seen both of our kids just blossom here, and, you know, leadership opportunities and involvement that we never thought that they would get into. But the campus is small enough that they can get involved, but big enough that, you know, they can't be involved in everything, and they still have to make choices and prioritize. And I think it's just a perfect opportunity for them to grow, you know, not only in their educational environment, but spiritually and just as leaders in whatever they decide to do.
For Samford University, I'm Brad Radici.
Well, we are back here live from the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium just before the second half action gets underway. As you remember, the Bulldogs left the first half with a relatively comfortable 2-0 lead. It has warmed up a bit here during halftime, and the sky has cleared up a bit as well. We're finally seeing some blue up there, so the dreary overcast is gone, and the sun is shining on this Bulldog lead as the Bucks have a bit of work to do to get back into this one. Macy, what do you want to see from the visitors to maybe get a little bit more of a foothold in the second half?
Honestly, I think come out just like they did in the first half. If they come out with that energy and really attacking the ball fast, especially in the midfield, I think they'll be able to get a shot on goal. They struggled in the later part of the last half. When they did get the ball in the midfield, they didn't have anyone up top except maybe one person to distribute it to. So I think they also need to work on really moving up the field faster.
Well, the Dogs will be back out in their white tops, blue bottoms, going from right to left on your screen. ETSU, of course, attacking from left to right. Did make one mistake, which I was quickly corrected on in the first half, saying that ETSU was in second place in the Southern Conference table. They are not. They are in third behind Furman, who picked up the W on Friday to put them into second place. So it is the Dogs at the top and ETSU in third, but it is still a very tight race. This game, of course, having a huge impact on those standings. And following this one, just two matches left next weekend for the Bulldogs before concluding the regular season. Won't be the last time that you see myself and Macy, as we're going to be here to cover, in all likelihood, of course, the first round of the Southern Conference Tournament. That one, of course, hosted by the higher seed, which I was actually making the assumption would be Samford. Can't say that for sure yet.
Unless anything dramatic happens, I think hopefully it will be Samford.
We're back underway in the second half here. Bucks getting us started.
Bucks starting out with possession of the ball.
Ann McCurley, despite her best efforts, could not keep that one in. Number three for the visitors. Sliding.
Something a little bit interesting, Eric, I didn't know if you knew. ETSU's men's soccer team was able to actually pull off a win against number two North Carolina in the latter part of September. Thought that was very interesting, especially a great accomplishment for the ETSU soccer program as a whole.
Did not know that, as Macy continues to show me up in the knowledge department and the research skills. Dogs on the offensive here. This is Borman on it now. Not too much pressure on her as she looks to exchange passes with Kelly, who's just done her best to hold on to it. And now Jones makes a little bit of space for herself. Baggett is there in support. Can't quite get by McCurley in any meaningful fashion, and it will be a goal kick for ETSU keeper Leanne Cutshaw.
I don't know what you think, but it doesn't really look like the energy and momentum ETSU had coming into this game is translated over to this start of the second half.
Not in these early stages.
Georgia Allen letting Samford win it very easy right there in the midfield. Not what we saw, especially from her in the beginning of this first half.
Now Borman has space to put a cross in. Three to aim at in the area. And it was over the head of Kelly, and Cutshaw was out to do a little bit of catching practice.
Cutshaw is going to be vital in this game if Samford keeps attacking like they have been.
Well, she was vital in the first half as she came up with two or three really stellar saves. couldn't keep the Bulldogs out in the end.
Right, and this Bucks team is giving Samford lots of time on the ball. Positive for Samford, negative for the Bucks. That's not good to let Samford do.
Now here's Goldani, very quiet in the first half. Pass is intercepted here. Now see if the Senway is charging forward. She's got runners in front, Borman and Baggett. Trying to pick out Baggett. Had she slipped that on the inside, may have picked her out.
Right, as you mentioned, Goldani being quiet coming into this game, I thought she would be one of the key impact players for this ETSU team, and she has been quiet. You've seen way more action coming in the midfield and from those midfield players.
Yep, Goldani, the native of Ferrara, Italy. She has scored in 7 straight games for the Bucks and 8 straight Southern Conference games. So she is an important piece of the puzzle. As Kelly nearly able to cut past her defender. She is one of 15, get this, 15 foreign players on this ETSU Buccaneers roster. There are only 25 total on the roster, so there's more foreign influence than there are Americans. 5 of those players hail from the UK, 4 of them from Italy, 2 from Switzerland, and then 1 from Greece, 1 from Sweden, and 1 from Australia. Pardon me, 1 more. 1 from Australia and 1 from Austria. So a lot of European soccer powerhouses here, and they try and turn the tide with the curler coming from Goldini. Is right at Anna Maddox.
Goldini putting her hands on her head as she knew that was her opportunity to seize right there.
It was a chance from almost nothing, and she quickly got onto that ball and could not quite place it around Maddox, who was a good 7 yards out of her goal by the time the shot came in.
Right, but going back to the members of this team, you've got to imagine the culture of that team, how neat it is to be able to play by alongside people from such different parts of the world.
Seen a couple of very skillful players put on good displays this afternoon. Speaking of other parts of the world, here is the South African Jermaine Seopesenwe. Collinson in more of an advanced role here in the second half, and her ball over the top towards Hodgson's a good one. Chance for Hodgson inside the area. The cross is looking for Goldani.
Nice job by Emily Jones, really hustling to get back after she got beat on that. Samford, I'm sure, thought that maybe they had drawn that ETSU player offsides, but they did not get the call.
Speaking of Emily Jones, she was one of the standout performers in that first half for the Bulldogs. I thought her and Caitlin Orman especially very, very quietly put in big shifts, especially on the defensive side of the ball. Allie Laurie will chase this one down. She's being pressured by Goldani, and easy enough to get by her using Manid as an outlet. And here is Orman. Here's McNeil. Sending it long towards Jones. McNeil and Jones, 2 of the 3 Samford players, the third being Anna Allen, that have started every single match of the season so far for the Samford Bulldogs. They have been the 3 mainstays in the starting lineup all year long. Anna Allen and Emily Jones, of course, seniors. So not hugely surprising to see them getting as many starts as they do, but Virginia McNeil, just the junior out of Charlotte, North Carolina.
Right, and Virginia McNeil, you see her so often in games, really being the distributor in the midfield as she steps up from that defensive line.
Kelly has a chance to put a cross in. Baggett's there, and the first time shot was going up into the roof of the net, but not before Cutshaw's fingertips pushed it over the crossbar. Big chance for the Dogs to make it 3.
I'll give that save to Cutshaw. That was a nice save, I thought. There was also a nice touch there as well.
Baggett, I'm sure, is disappointed to have not found the back of the net from that kind of range.
Right. Emily Jones with the fake there.
Now Kelly has a chance. And Kelly's got her goal. She heads it back across face. And it rolls in towards the back corner. Samford leads 3-0 over ETSU.
Nice job by Kelly there. She was standing by herself there. No one really on her to apply any pressure. And that will put her up to, not really, let's look, 5 goals for this season.
I believe that cross came off the head of Caitlin Orman until it looped into a perfect position for Malkinesha Kelly to just nod it in towards the back post. Not too much work to be done there as she picked her spot and placed the ball very well. And now the Dogs really out in front here, grabbing that early goal in the second half.
Definitely something they needed, and maybe they'll even be able to get some of those younger girls back in like they had the first half and get some playing time for them. This will be, if they're able to pull it out, a nice win for them as they will go on the road for their last two SoCon matchups and games of this regular season. They'll head to UNCG on Friday and then to VMI on Sunday. It's the opposite for their opponent, ETSU, tonight, as this is their last game on the road for the regular season, and then they'll head home for their last two games against Wofford and Furman next weekend.
Neat touch in the middle of the park by Siopa Senwe. She's galloping forward, has 3 runners in front of her, and her and Baggett not quite thinking on the same wavelength there. McNeil got the ball back in possession, and now here's Borman trying to get it towards Baggett again. Nothing doing on that occasion. We were talking about Virginia McNeil, all the appearances and starts she's made as just a junior. She's normally plied her trade on the left and right side of the defense this season, but since Allie Laurie joined Olivia Cole in the center, she has stepped up into that more defensive midfield role where you'll see her right now in front of the Samford back four. With so many seniors graduating, having a player like her with the experience she does under her belt sticking around for another year will be vital for this Dogs team in the coming seasons. Now here's Hodgson trying to pick out Goldani, but Allie Laurie aware to make the interception.
Right, that was a nice step by Allie Laurie and nice communication by that Samford defensive line to know who was stepping and who was staying there.
Orman trying to play the one-touch pass. Now here's a chance for Goldani. Can she get there before Cole? And she nearly slid underneath Anna Maddox, who is off her line very quickly to snuff out the danger.
That was a nice job there by Anna Allen and Anna Maddox to communicate as they both were going for the ball at the same time.
There's the back heel from Siopa Senwe, and it does find Borman. Looking for the run of Kelly.
As the sun is starting to come from behind those clouds, Samford going into the sunlight. The weather this morning hasn't really affected the game. The field when I got here was a little wet, but haven't really seen any problems from that.
The high quality grass here at the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium stood up to the test. Now here's Emily Jones. Got Baggett in plenty of space, makes the easy pass to her. And she wants to find Siopa Senwe in the area. It's cut out before it can get to her, though. Baggett not giving up. Borman with some space at the top. Kelly trying to get it wide towards Siopa Senwe, now trying to double back. Thought she was fouled in the process. Here's Siopa Senwe, laying it into the path of Manid. Dummies once, cuts twice, puts the cross in. It's at the back post for Jones, and she can't quite keep it in.
Talking about Jones being an impact player, once again you see it there, not only on the defensive side of the ball, but also the offensive coming up into that role.
Love to know the amount of ground that Emily Jones covers on a weekly basis. She's up and down that left-hand flank all the time for the Dogs. Speaking of the Dogs, they're making a change. Number 21, Lindsay Copeland, has entered the match. Lindsay, the 5'9 freshman from right here in Birmingham, Alabama, just her third appearance of the season this afternoon. She's going to get in on the action as the Dogs have a commanding 3-0 lead, just over 30 minutes left in the second half.
Ryan, I definitely think the Samford Bulldogs have taken control of this game. Just about 32 minutes of play remaining. Samford leading 3-0 against the ETSU Bucks.
Good work from Jones once again, and now McNeil finds herself in possession. Goldani working hard to get it back, but nothing doing for her still today.
Right, you know she has to be frustrated. The opportunity she's had half, she was unlucky on that touch there when she was one-on-one with Anna Maddox.
There's Borman chasing one down, trying to get there before it rolls out for an ETSU goal kick, but she can't quite make it. Buccaneers will be able to restart us. I mentioned earlier that ETSU have been perfect at home this season. Well, what a year then to host the Southern Conference Tournament. It's the first time they're doing it in their school history. And if their hometown pitch has been as much of a fortress, or continues to be as much of a fortress as it has been for them in the regular season, they will be a force to be reckoned with in the tournament coming up in just 2 weeks. Dogs making a change. Corey Sauter coming in for Ella Baggett.
Right, talking about ETSU hosting this tournament for the first time ever. Their athletic department has really been growing in the last few years. They also brought back football a couple years ago and are working on building a new stadium for their football team as they rejoin the SoCon in 2014.
Well, that was Borman trying to wiggle free of some challenges. Another change being made here. Well, here's something you don't see often. Olivia Cole stepping off of the pitch. She looks to be fine. Normally a mainstay, but Anna Allen coming in for her, and Virginia McNeil then shifting back alongside Allie Laurie in the center of the defense for the Bulldogs.
What amazes me so much about when you have these Samford substitutions, big names come off the field, but big names always go back in. This team is so stacked.
Olivia Cole getting a rest that she doesn't see too often. She has played more minutes than any other Bulldog on the team so far this season. She's up over 1,000 by some distance now. That's a bit of an outdated stat. That was last Friday. And she'll get a well-deserved rest for the final 30 minutes here this afternoon.
Malkanisha Kelly a little upset. She definitely thought that she had won that throw-in. I also thought that it had gone off an ETSU's shin guards.
Well, hard challenge in the center of the park from Lori, McNeil, is quick to apologize for the little bit of the push in the back she gave to Goldani. Buccaneers going to have the free kick.
Samford fans a little upset as she tried to get a little bit more space for that free kick there.
I actually thought the foul was committed a couple yards in front of where the kick's being taken from, but I could be wrong.
So maybe she was correct there.
Just goes to show you how unbiased I am, of course. Both teams battling away for possession, and that was a hard challenge there from number 14, Molly Collinson. And I believe the referee has given the free kick, not the throw. Here's Allen now for the Dogs. She's got it out wide to Copeland. sees the space in front of her. She wants to put this one into the area. Dogs have another chance to do so. Now Siopa Senwe gets her shot, cutting back and forth. She was past two defenders, couldn't beat the third.
And Allen able to get some pressure on her for Samford to win the ball back.
Emily Jones with another interception. For anyone who's keeping count this afternoon, that makes it a lot of interceptions for Emily Jones. Although she does concede the free kick. Maybe not too smartly taken quickly by the Buccaneers, who were quickly under pressure from Kelly. They have managed to find the outlet, though. And Kelly wants it over the top early from Siopa Senwe. She's onside Malkanisha Kelly. Can she do it here? It's Kelly. And that heavy first touch.
Right.
It was Cutshall. Could smother up the danger.
I think Malkanisha Kelly knew right when she had that first touch that it was a little bit too far. But Jermaine Siopa Senwe put her in perfect position with that ball.
Well, I saw Kelly on the shoulder of the last defender put her arm up, and I knew Siopa Senwe would put in a quality ball. That's a position I'm surprised we haven't seen Kelly in more often this season, given the talent around her, as the Buccaneers continue to attack.
Right, and with Kelly's speed, she's so easy to get, easily able to get past those defenders, no matter what team she's going up against.
Wants it short now, though. Here's Kelly on the ball. Sauter with no option is dispossessed by McCurley. Now here's Georgia Allen trying to roll one in front of Goldani. The idea was there, the execution was not.
Goldani has, though, surprisingly stayed very much in the center of the field. I think if she would try to maybe go a little bit to the corners more so with those three balls to get herself in position for that, it might help her out a little bit more in receiving the ball.
See if Assembly's picked it up inside her own half. Just Kelly in front of her. Receiving support on this near side from Sauter now. Wanted to go out wide for Kelly.
Little bit of physical play there on the ground.
Well, Lori and Orman combining well to win back possession for the Dogs. And now here's Lindsay Copeland. She's going along towards Siopa Senwe, whose first touch is an excellent one.
Siopa Senwe with lots of time there.
Great ball. Now Sauter with a real chance here. Wants to go back across the face of goal instead of go it alone. And the attempted clearance bounces into the hands of Leon Cutshall.
Nice attack there. I think Sauter probably thought her angles weren't exactly right to send that ball in. Nice thought, just an unlucky pass.
Wouldn't have blamed her for taking a shot at 3-0 up. Definitely a position I probably would have gone for it. Here's Georgia Allen cutting inside. Can't get past McNeil, but she is adjudged to have been fouled as got caught in the middle of a sandwich between Virginia and Emily Jones.
McNeil definitely not happy about that foul. She throws her arms in the air.
Don't think she has too much to complain about. Arena Brooch is going to send this one in with the left foot. Plenty to aim at. It's a good one, too. Samford defense able to not only make the clearance, but, referee has given the corner kick.
Virginia McNeil hustled extremely hard to try to keep that in and not give up the corner kick.
It was Brooch over the free kick. It will be Brooch over the corner kick for the Buccaneers. Still searching for that goal. Here comes the in-swinger.
That was a nice, powerful corner there.
Well, four changes being made here by Samford. Aaron Bonner is entering the match alongside Abriella Argueta, Sarah Smeltzer, and Keely Borman. Coming off, Jermaine Siopasenwe, Taylor Borman, Malkanisha Kelly, and Caitlin Orman. Samford head coach Todd Yelton doing me the favor of not putting Taylor Borman, Caitlin Orman, and Keely Borman all on the field at the same time.
I'm sure he's thinking about you when he's doing these substitutions.
I do. He's a thoughtful man. I do appreciate it.
I believe Ariana Brucewich, number 13 for the Bucks, also came out of that game. Didn't quite get who came into the match for her, but we'll try to figure that out.
McCurley trying to curl one into the pass of Goldani. They've tried to play that ball a couple of times over the last 10 or 15 minutes or so. ETSU haven't found it successful yet. Well, Argueta's found a nice pass over the top towards Borman, who is just offside.
Nice call there. She was a little bit offsides.
Just not timing the run perfectly yet, Keely Borman.
Right, true freshman in this game from Georgetown, Kentucky. Such a great recruiting class.
Younger sister, of course, of Taylor Borman, the senior.
When the team was asked how they felt about these seniors leaving, of course, they're very emotional, but they also thought that next year they're going to be just as good. They definitely have a nice freshman class right now, as well as a very encouraging recruiting class coming in, they believe. Definitely hopeful for the Samford team next year.
Here's Bonner inside the 18. She's going to win a corner kick for the Bulldogs.
Corner kick for Samford.
Going to be Sauter going all the way across to take this one. Just 20 minutes left before the full-time whistle. Dogs still in the commanding 3-0 lead.
Right.
And making a change also. Taylor Minnie coming in for Emily Jones.
Well-deserved rest there for Emily Jones. But this will be great momentum going into these last two games for Samford and going into the SoCon Conference Tournament. Hopefully completing the dream that they wish to make it to the NCAA tournament this year. And I think they definitely have a shot at it this year.
Here's Hodgson for the visitors. Trying to get something going, does find Goldani this time, and she is called offside. Been a rough one up front for Eleonora Goldani in the second half.
And Eric, remind me, has ETSU been shut out in a few games, or has that only happened once this year?
Only one all season. We're looking at the Dogs putting up another one, a big feat for the home side, should they hold on here.
If Samford is able to come away with this win, they will move the all-time series record up to 4-1. Crazy to think this is only the fifth time that these schools have played each other in school history.
Manid's been involved a lot over these last few minutes, seeing a lot of action. Does have an assist under her belt this afternoon. And the Samford defense remains strong. Anna Allen with the clearance on this occasion. And somewhere, The referee has seen a foul.
I think that would be on Georgia Allen there.
Minid wants to go short with the free kick. Lori not in the best position to put a good foot through the ball. But the Dogs do have the throw. Minid under it once again. Goldini with a neat step over, but couldn't get past Anna Allen, who has seamlessly shifted into the center of the defense for the Bulldogs, as if nothing has changed. Now Smeltzer in the middle of the park. Here's Sauter. Pass is behind Bonner. We'll have to chase it down. Bonner cutting inside. She's inside the 18. She's past one defender. Can't beat the second. It will come right back at the Buccaneers, though, as Smeltzer is on it once again. No options for her on this near side, so she goes the other way.
Still able to maintain possession. Great job there by her.
Smeltzer again. Cutting onto her left foot, and the cross goes in, dealt with by the ETSU back line. Now McNeil's on it. Here's Keely Borman. Shot takes a deflection, and harmlessly over the crossbar. Looks like three changes are going to be made here. Caitlin Orman and Ella Baggett are checking back into the game for Samford. Virginia McNeil and Lindsay Copeland are making space for them. And let's not forget the goalkeeping substitution. Anna Maddox stepping out. Katie Peters getting some action in between the posts for these final 16 minutes.
Right, and Katie Peters is a goalie that we saw a little bit more so at the beginning of this year. I think because of an injury of Anna Maddox, I believe.
Yeah, Samford head coach Todd Yelton has been happy over the last couple of seasons to switch back and forth between the two of them. That absolute wealth of talent between the sticks for the Bulldogs. And it was an early season injury to Maddox that kept her out for the first few games, where Katie Peters performed exceptionally. And then I believe it was Peters who took a knock in the road trip to Texas, allowed Maddox to get back in between the posts, and she has been spectacular in her time there. Really established herself as the number one, but Peters getting some minutes here this afternoon. And while we were discussing that, Arena Brooch checked back into the game for the visiting side. Here's Goldani. Tough tackle from Manid, and now Smeltzer's on the ball. Nearly got it to Bonner up top. And a quick step from Ella Baggett has the Dogs charging forward now. She wants to go straight towards Bonner. She finds her. Bonner has Borman in support. She's going to go it alone. And that one high over the crossbar from Aaron Bonner.
Goldani really trying to make something happen. It's a very unlucky night for her.
Game getting a little bit stretched now. There's a lot of space in between the two back lines. Both teams nearly counterattacking just in this last minute. Here's Collinson. She's going to get to the byline, and the low cross from Collinson comes in, and Katie Peters is down quickly to her right. Make an exceptional save. She has been on the bench for most of the game, but on her toes on this occasion. Dogs nearly through. Now Bonner has a chance. She's going to take it wide, and the shot is going to come from her early.
Bonner really trying to get those shots out early. She probably had a little bit more time on the ball, but definitely a nice touch to get past that defender.
Here's Georgia Allen. Gets it up towards Hodgson. Might fall in the box for Goldani. Baggett able to knock it clear.
ETSU trying to string together some passes to get the ball upfield to Goldani.
Here come the Buccaneers. It's 4-on-3, real chance, and the deflection nearly gets up over Katie Peters. Once again, though, the redshirt junior goalkeeper on her toes to make the save. She has been huge since coming in and has found herself in an eventful last 15 minutes.
All right, she's seen a lot of action. Definitely very impressive that she's able to come off the bench and not being in the last few games and make these amazing saves. Samford with plenty of time in the midfield.
Knocking the ball around nicely here.
Kaylin Orman filling into that position of Virginia McNeil.
And here comes the cross. It's towards Bonner. I believe that's Bruch charging up the left-hand flank. She's still going. Has three to aim at in the area. She's all the way to the byline. And a couple of unlucky bounces mean that Samford gets the clearance. And ETSU goes without the corner kick. A lot of space in between the two back lines here. Sarah Smelter's coming forward with it now. Game very stretched in the late stages. Here's Argueta.
She'll be called offside. Just about 10 minutes remaining in the game. Samford still up 3-0 over the ETSU Buccaneers. Goldani trying to make something out of that unlucky touch by Samford.
Both sides making changes. Maya Watford is coming back into the match. Really great to see her already back into the action in this one. Also number 16, Emma Thompson, getting in on things this afternoon.
Right, I think it's especially crucial that Maya Waffer was able to get back in this game. Obviously, she has passed some sort of concussion protocol test. That's nice to see that she won't be having to miss these next few ending SoCon Conference road games.
ETSU also made a couple changes. Rachel Harbin and Courtney Gaylord entered the game. Allen with a very nice ball out wide towards Thompson. And here is Watford's first touch since coming in.
She has all the time that she needs right now, just taking touches.
Here's Argueta now. She finds Watford. Watford has the run of Thompson in front of her, and Thompson wants to put it in quickly.
So much room now in the midfield, like you've been saying, Eric.
We do have a player down on the far side. I believe that's Emma Thompson. looking to be in some discomfort here. The athletic trainers are on their way out.
All right, the play will stop at 8 minutes and 15 seconds remaining.
Emma, the 5'7 sophomore, she's from Huntsville, Alabama. Just her seventh appearance of the year this afternoon. She receives attention over in that far corner.
All right, it seems that they are looking at her leg. Looks like Mia Dubrock will come in for her.
Yeah, Emma Thompson has not made her way off the pitch as of yet, but looks like she will be making way very shortly. Coming in for her, the 5'3 freshman, Mia Dubrock, midfielder out of Mandeville, Louisiana. This is her fourth appearance of the season, and she does have one assist to her name. As Thompson continues to receive treatment in the far corner. Well, Samford's three goals in this game mean that they have continued to score. They have only been shut out on one occasion this season. That was their regular season opener away to South Alabama, where they drew 0-0. Since then, they have scored at least once in all 13 of their games. That goes all the way back to the middle of August. So a very offensively potent Samford Bulldog team continues to get it done. We've seen them do it three times this afternoon. Emma Thompson is back on her feet and walking on her own volition here.
Very nice to see for sure. Speaking on Samford, their only loss is coming from Georgia, number 24 ranked Auburn and Furman. Definitely two SEC schools, very big names. Furman game, very big opponent in the SEC conference. They have now dropped two losses in the SoCon conference, excuse me. They have now dropped, Furman has, to two losses. They are in second place with Samford right now in first place, securing that with this win today.
Yeah, that loss to Furman came as a bit of a surprise, as this Bulldog team picked in the preseason to top the Southern Conference table for another year, third year in a row, actually. That loss to Furman, an early blip in that form, but there might be a chance here for the Dogs to get something. Cutshaw is out quickly.
Right, an early hurdle to face, but they've been able to come back and are back on top of that SoCon conference. Once again, with only two more games to face, UNCG on Friday and VMI on Sunday, both road games will finish out their regular season play as well as their SoCon conference play.
Now Bonner switches it to Smeltzer. Smeltzer wants to try and get across in. Well, it's a shot in the end, and it's off the crossbar.
Crowd reaction from that, as they definitely thought that was going to go in. A nice shot there.
Well, Lindsay Copeland, as quick as she left, is back into the match. Ella Baggett will take a seat in her stead. Copeland now in the left back role on this near side. Dogs with their eyes into the sun. A lot in this second half. Watford working hard, and her hard work means that Dubrock has a chance to put a cross in. A little bit of time for her. Dubrock using Copeland as an outlet. Ball comes in from Copeland, not a bad one.
I think that'll be high kick there, probably.
Interesting decision by the referee, as the ETSU defender, believe it was Fiona Dodge, was lowering, or pardon me, believe it was Elena Pisani, was lowering her head. But referee gave the high boot. Here's Sauter.
Georgia Allen down, kind of struggling to get up. She gets to her feet.
Bonner with a neat turn, trying to find Dubrock. It was Gaylord who was aware. And a strong challenge comes in from DeBrock, but she can't win the throw-in. Just under 6 minutes remaining before the referee ends this one. Dog still with the commanding 3-0 lead. Argetta brings it forward now. Her pass is intercepted. Collinson can't get it past Sauter.
Just 5 minutes remain between Samford being able to call this one a game and end this weekend with two wins.
Well, that ball snuck past Ariella Argetta, and now here's Brooch one-on-one with Peters. She's going to try and slide it towards Georgia Allen. Ball not cleared, and the shot is once again off the line. This time it was Copeland, who's put in two blocks, and Samford keeps the shutout against all odds there.
Right, Lindsay Copeland, true freshman, coming in strong there with an initial stop and then the two blocks following that.
Well, Brooch is over this corner kick now. We'll talk a little bit more as soon as it comes in. The inswinger is too close to Peters. I thought that Brooch had a real opportunity to just go one-on-one with Peters and try and open the scoring for the Buccaneers.
Right, great job there by Lindsay Copeland realizing and cutting in to get in front of that pass there as it would have been an open goal. Definitely a scary moment for a true freshman trying to maintain the shutout, but she responded well.
She handled it like a true senior. As we have been watching for these last 15 minutes the future of the Samford Bulldogs. A lot of freshmen, sophomores, and juniors on the pitch right now. Getting some valuable Southern Conference play experience.
Against a pretty good team. One of the better teams that Samford has seen. Definitely playing their best in this first half, ETSU. But a pretty good opponent that they might end up seeing once again in the SoCon tournament. ETSU will win the throw-in. Actually, excuse me, I think it'll be a free kick there.
Here's Gaylord bringing it into space for the Buccaneers. Wants to send one up the line towards Harbin, and Peters all the way out of her box to knock that one out.
Right, nice communication there by Peters and Allie Laurie. Buccaneers fighting hard, trying to get at least something on the board to prevent their second shutout of the season. This will also break their four-game undefeated streak.
Watford going to shoulder on that far sideline. Does not get the throw in on this occasion. Now Copeland with some work to do as she's being chased down by Georgia Allen. Argetta tracking back defensively up against Brooch. Brooch turning onto her right foot. Could be a chance here for Georgia Allen.
Easy shot. Save there for Katie Peters.
Too easy in the end.
You have to wonder if ETSU is wishing that they had kept Goldani in this game a little bit longer, as they have had some pretty successful looking attacks in these last 5 minutes or so.
And the one time through ball is nearly past Lori and into the path of McCurley. Here's Smeltzer again, dropping very deep in these last 15 minutes, getting on the ball plenty.
One last attack for ETSU with Georgia Allen.
Thought for a moment Allen might have a real chance to put it away, but Peters was off her line, and that is going to bring us to the full-time whistle as time expires here at the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium. Bulldogs take home the victory, and it's a big one. 3-0 over the Buccaneers. With the win, Samford improves to 10-3-2 overall on the season, 6-1 in the Southern Conference. Their win streak is up to 5 straight games. They're 7-1 now at home this year, and they improve their all-time record against ETSU to 4-1. ETSU, meanwhile, falls to 9-5-2 on the year, 4-2-1 in the Southern Conference. Their four-match unbeaten streak is broken, and they are an abysmal 1-4 against Samford all-time. Let me run through some stats here with you quickly. 10 shots from the Buccaneers this afternoon. 8 of those were on goal, but none of them found the back of the net as Anna Maddox and Katie Peters combined to hold the shutout. 3 saves between the two of them. On the other hand, the Samford Bulldogs took 13 shots. 6 of those were on goal, and half of those went in. 8 saves for Cutshaw as her net was peppered throughout the afternoon. Coming up next for Samford Soccer, it's the final weekend of the regular season, which sees the Dogs travel to UNCG for a Friday night match and then conclude the 2016 regular season on Sunday at VMI Next. As the Dogs chase another Southern Conference title. Keep up with all the action online at SanfordSports.com. That's going to do it for us here today. Let me thank the crew just very quickly. My boss, Jonathan McAfoos, thanks for being okay with me being 20 minutes late. Luke DeMarco, Hannah Diamond, and Megan Roach doing excellent work as always. Macy Marin, it was another wonderful weekend of soccer. Always a pleasure to have you alongside me.
Thank you, Eric. The pleasure is mine.
Our final score here from the Samford Track and Soccer Stadium, it's Samford 3, Eastern Tennessee State University 0. Until next time, I'm Eric Biancolana saying so long for now. This has been Samford Bulldog Soccer on the SoCon Digital Network.